Hello and welcome to The Big Picture. Right from the time the Indian Constitution was in the making, the debate over whether we should have an uniform civil code has raged in this country. The Constitution makers decided that time then was not ripe to go ahead with trying to formulate a common code and left it for posterity with the directive principle that we should strive to have one. It is 66 years since then, and we continue to debate the pros and cons of adopting a common code. However, there is a difference now. The NDA government has formally asked the Law Commission to look into the issue and present a report. Even as the Commission starts preparing to have consultations, the issue has not surprisingly assumed political colors. The motive behind the move is being questioned by opposition parties, while a section of minority leaders are expressing their concerns. While all these objections and concerns will have to be addressed, the question is, where does one begin to find consensus? We will discuss this today with KTS Tulsi, senior advocate in the Supreme Court and a Rajya Sabha member, Tahir Mahmood, former chairman, National Commission for Minorities, Gopal Krishna Agarwal, national spokesperson of the BJP, John Dayal, writer and social activist, and on the phone line from Srinagar is Justice B.A. Khan, former Chief Justice, Jammu and Kashmir High Court. Welcome to all of you. Justice Khan, for 70 years, we have almost 70 years we have managed in this country without a common civil code. Do you think that there is a need for it now?
This is a very tricky and sticky issue. And it can be argued both ways, whether there is a need or whether there is not a need. But for the present, I believe that it would be somewhat inviting some kind of a trouble if one goes ahead with it, and if the thing is imposed without having a consensus on the issue. Because if you appreciate that we have arguments on both sides, it is good to say that we are a secular republic and that we need a common law for all citizens, and as distinct from differentiated laws which we have based on the religious practices and so on and so forth. It's also good to say that it would promote some kind of a national integration, or it may lead to some kind of a gender justice. But all that is okay. But the other side of the picture is also to be seen. We are a country, we have to maintain the unity in the diversity. This country is inhabited by people of all hues and colors and religions and cultures and languages. Now, therefore, if there is a viewpoint that the particular religious law arises from a religion, for example, talking about the Sharia law springs from Quran, and Quran, the Muslims believe, is unalterable, it's unamendable, and it cannot be changed by any constitution, or it can't be reflected or adapted on. So that viewpoint has to be accommodated by some kind of a consensus. And unless that consensus is reached, I believe this will not lead to a national integration. It may have other results also. So therefore, it's a time for caution.
Okay.
Bulldozing it and imposing it would not be serving the purpose we are looking for.
Okay. Okay, I think that's a cautionary note on which you have started. Gopal Krishna Agarwal, why is there a need today? Why do you think a government has, put forth this?
The need has not arrived now. The need was, as you mentioned, that I think the need was when we got independence, because our forefathers in the constitution and itself mentioned that we should have a uniform civil code. That was the objective. Ultimately, it was delayed for this many years. I think and at present also we are not thinking of imposing anything. It is just it was there in our manifesto. It is the need of the hour that we should have a larger debate, and there are several aspects out of it which have been left out of the public debate or domain. Whether it is a human right issue, whether it is of the gender equality, and I think from the Uniform Civil Code we have to distinguish that it is not with regard to religious practices. It is not controlling or harming or talking of religious practices of any community or minority as such. It is talking of, there has to be a segregation between aspects like marriage, divorce, inheritance, which are in the domain of civil laws. And ultimately, when we have to go towards the secular credential of the constitution or go towards the secular credential of the nation, we should have, like we have a uniform criminal code, we should have a uniform civil code where rights of the women are protected, human rights of the people are protected, and we have a uniformity with regard to implementation of these day-to-day
you think
affairs.
That, you think those are not protected now in the present circumstance?
There are several cases. If you go into what the Muslim Mahila Andolan and other people themselves are demanding, that 92%, there is a survey in Times of India recently, that 92% of the women are demanding that the law regarding to marriage and divorce should be modified. They are not getting equal rights. And on the face of it, it is seen that women are not at an equal status with regard to men.
This is regarding as far as the Muslims are concerned.
Yeah, minority.
Muslim. This is a Muslim issue.
Yes, Muslim minority. That's a major important issue. And mostly the reservation is coming from them also. Ultimately, our contention is that we should have now a larger debate where the stakeholders from that community only, if they are demanding, that the government is required to take it their considerations.
So what you're trying to say is that, or you know, this the problem lies in the fact that when you talk of uniform civil code, we are talking mainly of the minorities, the problems within the minority communities. What about the majority community? That is where the problem. I think that is where the debate has to be enlarged. And yeah. Let me get Mr. Tahir Mahmood on this. Mr. Tahir Mahmood, you know, what is this uniform? The concept of uniform civil code, when it is discussed in this country, inevitably the Muslims feel very, you know. There is a certain amount of discomfort as far as the Muslims are concerned. There is a feeling that it is aimed at them. Is that the problem there? Is there a problem there?
There is a reason behind the discomfort of the Muslim community, because there is no clear picture of what a uniform civil code will be like. For 60 years, more than 66 years, it is there in the constitution, but no government has tried to give a draft to the various communities. It is just talking in the air. Everybody is talking in the air. Nobody even exactly what the Article 44 says. Even about that, there are differences of opinion. The concept is not clear. Somebody started with saying common civil code. Now, please, for heaven's sake, understand that there is a difference between common and uniform. And the Constitution of India, Article 44, speaks of uniform civil code. And it does not ask Parliament or the state to enact it straight away. The wordings are, the state shall endeavor to secure. The word used there is secure, which doesn't mean straight away having one single law and replacing all the personal laws with it. If that was the concept of uniform civil code, then I want to ask, in 1954, a general law of marriages was already enacted. Then what was the need for enacting a separate Hindu Marriage Act in 1955, just 1 year later? And similarly, we had a Guardians and Wards Act already enacted in 1890. It was applicable to everybody. Then what was the reason for enacting a Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act in 1956? We had an Indian Succession Act, 1925. And yet, a Hindu Succession Act was enacted in 1956. So the difficulties and actually the real concept of uniformity under Article 44 has been clear. You know, the idea is that there should be uniformity in the laws, family laws to be enacted. Now onwards, there should be uniformity as far as possible. And since 1954, a very large number of laws have been enacted which apply to every community, whether they are the Muslims or the Hindus or whoever they are. We have the Dowry Prohibition Act, we have the Special Marriage Act, we have recently enacted the Domestic Violence Act and Maintenance of Parents and Senior Citizens Act, and then the Child Marriage Prohibition Act. They do apply to everybody, every community, every individual, whatever be his religion or his personal law. Now, mixing up the two things, personal law reform and a uniform civil code. These are entirely two different things.
Okay.
Hindu law has been reformed, amended drastically in 1955-56. Well, why don't we reform Muslim law? There is a crying need for amendment of Muslim law. But it seems that the government after government, they have been giving an option to the Muslim community that either you have to rot with your misinterpreted, misused and caricatured personal law, or you have to accept a uniform civil code. And the general feeling in various communities is that uniform civil code is a euphemism for the Hindu laws enacted in 1955-56, that they will be adopted as the uniform civil code.
That is
and
the tragedy.
To dispel that fear, there should be a draft.
Okay. Okay, sir.
There Mr. should
Tulsi,
be a draft.
Mr. Tulsi, so what is the concept of a uniform civil code? You know, legally, do you think that there is a concept now ready which the Law Commission can start working on?
You see, I don't know, whatever we may call uniform civil code, whether we adopt a uniform civil code or not, my view is that triple talaq is un-Islamic and unconstitutional. And therefore, the courts can straight away apply the right of equality under Article 14, a right of right to live with dignity under Article 21. And after all, Muslim women are citizens of India. And the supreme law of the land is the Constitution of India. Therefore, why do I say it is un-Islamic? Because the Muslim scholars themselves have interpreted Quran in Surah 65, verse 1, which requires waiting period, two waiting periods of 3 months each,
sir,
before the divorce can become
Tulsi,
valid under the Muslim law.
No, Mr.
Tulsi. So therefore,
Tulsi,
triple talaq in one sitting,
no, we are not,
say it, recited thrice.
Sir, we are, not, we are not discussing. Sir,
verse
we are not specifically.
Surah 65.
Sorry, sir. Sorry, Mr. Tulsi, we are not specifically discussing triple talaq. I had a larger question. My larger question is, the concept of a uniform civil code, is there a clarity legally about the concept of a uniform civil code? Do you think that there is something which is existing on the basis of which the Law Commission can start its work, which has been entrusted to it by the government?
I don't think uniform civil code is even required, because the Constitution of India does not permit discrimination between men and women. And if there is any discrimination on the basis of custom, etc., it will be ignored by the courts. And I want to say that 93% of the Muslim nations have already held that triple talaq is illegal. Pakistan is treating triple talaq as illegal since 1961.
But it is not just a question
of banned.
Sir, but it is not a question of just triple talaq. Triple talaq is just one of the issues when we talk of uniform civil code. I'll come back to you. John, how do you look at this? Do you think
that's right? I'm giving you an example.
I'm giving you an example. Mr. Tulsi,
you see, India is also a signatory.
Yes, sir.
To
sir, sir, I'll come back.
Convention on elimination of discrimination against women.
Sir, I'll come back to you. Let John finish his what he said.
But it's a very interesting intervention, because it does expose, if I may use the phrase, or tell, that the whole debate has been not only during this government but NDA 1, essentially meant to focus on triple talaq. And thereby politically to also target, if I may use the phrase again, the Muslim community. But I would say that it's much more than that.
It
should be much
exactly.
more than that. But can I just point out,
yes.
The directive principles are fine, everybody swears by them, but the internal contradictions, you have directive principles for banning cow slaughter, and you have directive principles enforcing a common civil code or a uniform civil code. Is there not a contradiction there to begin with? My argument would be that everybody welcomes reforms, and Christian women really have been long leading the urge for reforms. But also, we need to have a look at a larger picture. Have we purged the constitution of the many indices and factors where religion comes into the being? The Dalit issue, for instance, there are many other issues which are heavily loaded against Muslims and against Christians. And I think if you're going to look at it, and if it comes before a platform where discussion is possible, as in the Law Commission, and if there's a government demand, I would certainly like to ask them to also look at other issues of the Constitution, look at Article 341, Part 3, look at any other laws of there, and see if the Constitution's guarantees of equality of religion, equality of gender, and equality of other issues are equally as mandated, also implemented. Now, that is how to look at it.
Okay. You want to respond?
Yeah, what I want to tell is that what I've heard from on the panel is that everybody is agreeing that there should be a larger debate. And that's what our government is doing.
No.
They have referred it. There should be a public debate. Venkaiah Naidu had specifically said
Mr. Mahmood, Mr.
Law Commission will...
Tahir Mahmood says, and Mr. Tulsi feels that there is no need for a uniform civil code. Mm-hmm. Mr. Tahir Mahmood says that there is a need for a reformation of the Muslim laws, you know,
and
just like Hindu laws.
Every other person.
And every other person.
That is a part
laws.
Of the debate.
So why should there be a... So Mr. Justice Khan, you know, this aspect raised by Tahir Mahmood about the concept itself, is there a clarity of the concept? Do you have a clarity of that concept? Do you think the Law Commission can start its work with some amount of clarity?
Girish, let me first of all that there is some confusion about the concept itself.
Yes.
This concept of a uniform civil code, it's a proposal to replace all personal laws of other communities.
Of all the communities.
By a law which is uniform and which is common to all. Just as Dr. Tahir Mahmood brought it out beautifully, the distinction between the reform in personal law is one thing and uniform civil code is something different. You know, a bogey of triple talaq is being used to malign or to give a misinformation.
Absolutely.
On the issue of having this kind of a uniform civil code. Triple talaq is an issue which is engaging the attention of the Muslim community. This has engaged the attention of all Muslim countries.
Absolutely.
There have been reform in personal laws in other Muslim countries also. Therefore, Tahir Sahib is rightly saying, why can't we have a reform of Muslim laws in our country also? But as far as uniform civil code is concerned, that's a replacement. It's a substitution of all personal laws of the minority communities. Now, whether all those laws, for example, minorities are granted certain fundamental rights. If you look at Article 25, Article 26, and Article 29 of the Constitution, Article 25 gives a right to profess, propagate, and practice a person's religion. And so does Article 26.
And
it
that
gives
is under
a right
stress,
to manage its own affairs. And Article 29 gives an absolute right to preserve and conserve one's culture. Now, where a case is that, for example, my succession, a Muslim community believes that the succession, the inheritance, is recorded in the Quran. There are specific shares given to a wife, for example, 1:8. Dr. Tahir Mahmood knows it better. He's an expert on the field. Now, once you change that, it means you are changing a Quranic injection. Now, whether that Quranic injection can be changed by a replaced law is the issue. Second issue would be, see, there are so many challenges involved in the whole thing. Second issue would be, Parliament is not legislating something like a constitutional provision to override this. Parliament would be enacting a law only. Now, whether that law made by the Parliament, and it's not a constitution, mind you, whether that can replace a Quranic injection, as the argument goes, has to be seen. So therefore, this is not a simple affair, and triple talaq is nothing. It is something, some misinformation being spread. Who doesn't want this triple talaq to go?
No, in any
and
case,
who doesn't know this triple talaq is the most misconstrued thing in the Islamic law.
Yeah.
And if you go by the Quranic provisions, this is not how it is practiced.
But
therefore,
you know, unfortunately,
leave alone this triple talaq business, and come to the issue whether there should be a law made which should apply to all uniformly in place of their personal laws.
Exactly.
Which personal laws may arise from religion, which may arise from custom, may arise from practices.
One second.
For example, adoption.
Okay.
Christians do not entertain any adoption.
Parties
do not entertain any adoption. There is no provision in Islamic law of any adoption. So suppose tomorrow you make a law and make adoption permissible and valid. Now, how would it conflict with the personal laws of the
personal laws, exactly. Okay, sir. I think you have made some very substantive points there, Mr. Tulsi. Would you like to respond to it? No, in any case, as far as the triple talaq is concerned,
sir, one second.
As far as the triple talaq is concerned, the Supreme Court, at least, Supreme Court is right now, has taken up the case. Several Muslim women's organizations seems to have gone to the court and questioned the whole thing. So we will be, at some point of time, the Supreme Court will have to come out with its decision on this.
Well, I believe that the law already existing in this country is the Constitution of India. And the Constitution of India gives exactly, it does not permit discrimination between men and women on any ground whatsoever. And the supreme law of the land must prevail even with regard to Muslim women. And I want to say that India is also a signatory to the United Nations Convention on elimination of discrimination against women. If we are signatories, the courts also have to enforce this. When the Hindu court bill came, there were a number of customs which were disregarded. And the question is that the law, if there is a law which is not in conformity with the Constitution will prevail. And the Constitution Article 14 and 19 just can't be ignored so far as women, Muslim women are concerned. And therefore, I believe that whether there is a uniform civil code or not, the Constitution is sufficient and competent to protect Muslim women in India, and it must apply forthwith.
Okay.
We don't need another law.
Okay.
If we need another law with regard to adoption, etc., let that be.
Okay.
Okay. Can they come? It is not as simple as Mr. Tulsi is saying.
I'll come to you, sir.
No, this triple talaq was not the only issue in the country.
It's certainly not the only.
Because you see, Shah Bano case, there was an inherent.
It's certainly not. Triple talaq is not important.
That it is not the only reform for the personal law is required. But we need a debate on uniform.
The High Court has already declared Section 2 of the Muslim Personal Law
Preservation of the Secular a threat of the country.
Okay. Mr. Dr. Tahir Mahmood, please come in. You wanted to respond.
Yes, I want to clarify something. What Uniform Civil Code means, whether there is a need for that, whether it is possible, what will be the Uniform Civil Code. We are discussing these things for 66 years.
Right.
What is the immediate provocation now? The immediate provocation is that the Government of India has referred the issue to the Law Commission of India. Well, that's only a routine matter. The Law Commission of India exists for that. You may be knowing, Girish, that I have been a full-time member of the Law Commission in recent years.
Right.
I know that this is just a routine matter. And so it has been, look at the difference. Law Commission has not been asked to draft a Uniform Civil Code, nor is it their job.
They are supposed
to
provide a report.
The wordings are examine the issue.
And give a report.
Examine the issue of a Uniform Civil Code
and give
report
a report
to the government. No, it just says examine the issue and give a report.
Right.
Justice Lakshman has already given a report.
So they have to tell the government what actually Article 44 means. Sorry?
No, that there was a...
No, there has been no report let me say, please. Until now,
Justice
the Law Commission of India, which was set up in 1955 and is reconstituted every 3 years, the commission in these 66 years has not submitted any report on Law Commission. On the Uniform Civil Code. It has not examined the issue at all.
There is a report.
It's all wrong information which is being propagated in power. No, there is no report on Uniform Civil Code.
I'm saying it with
full confidence, with full sense of responsibility.
Justice Lakshman has been quoted as saying that he has given a report.
Sir, Justice Lakshman.
He has.
I'm also former vice chairman of the Law Commission. Please let me clarify.
Those two.
Mr. Mahmood, please clarify what I am saying.
Yes, the two reports which Justice Lakshmanan has referred to in his write-up in the Indian Express, those two reports were written by me. They are 100% my reports, and they do not examine the issue of Uniform Civil Code. One of them is on the law of civil marriages, which is full of discriminations, and it recommends certain measures to remove the discriminatory elements from the Special Marriage Act. The other is how to make compulsory registration of marriages, which the Supreme Court has directed. Laws to be enacted, in what way the laws can be enacted for the registration.
Okay, Mr. Vesey,
it doesn't say a word about uniform civil code.
But Mr. Ted,
whatever has come in the Indian Express story is baseless.
Okay, Mr. Mahmood. Mr. Mahmood, can that be
Law
the
Commission best? Has so
no,
far
Mr. Mahmood.
So far recommended.
Mr. Mahmood, can you? Mr. Mahmood, can I ask
complete.
You?
No, no. From 1955
no, Mr. Mahmood, you have said
now the Law Commission
Mr.
has
Mahmood,
submitted 262 reports.
Mr. Mahmood, can I?
262 reports. The Law Commission has
Mr.
submitted
Mahmood,
so far.
Mr. Mahmood, can I ask you a question?
Yep.
Can you that? Can Mr. Mahmood, can I ask
yes.
you a question? The reports which you mentioned, which you said
yeah,
you,
sure.
you have written on these marriages. Can they be the basis
yes.
from where the Law Commission can start? You know, because Justice Lakshmanan says that could be the starting point to begin with to have a common marriage act in this country. Is that the way to start? I'm just trying to figure out if there is any foundation on which the Law Commission can start its work.
Yeah, there is a foundation on not only those reports. There are 24 reports on various personal laws, on various aspects of family laws. Out of 262 reports so far submitted, 24 relate to family law. So they will obviously be examined and taken care of, and they will help the commission in examining the issue of a uniform
okay.
civil code. But
okay.
they deal with different personal laws.
Okay.
They all those reports, they deal with the issue of reform of personal laws. And I have said these are two entirely different things.
Okay,
nobody
sir.
Is saying that personal law should not be reformed.
All okay.
personal laws need reform. And Muslim law is certainly crying for reform.
Okay.
That should be the priority
sir,
of
you
the
have,
government.
Sir, you have mentioned that. John? So, you know, no, my question is this, John. You know, you think all communities, everybody now agrees that, you know, all personal laws need reforms, whether it's Christian personal laws, Muslim personal law, Hindu
sure.
personal law, you know, whatever. Do you think that, you know, the time has come for us to discuss, debate a uniform civil code, whether there's a possibility or not?
No, because to begin with, I think there are two aspects to it. This is a legal affair, which I think Tahir has explained it so beautifully well. The other is the political context in which these debates are precipitated, which create an ambience which makes sane debate impossible. Reforms in religion are the crying need and have been over the centuries, and reforms have taken place. The Parsi women need reforms, Christian women need reforms, not only about priesthood, adoption, everything else. Reforms as a sine qua non of modernizing religion, making it tenable for the future. The second thing is, but when you create this drum beating, when you create these drum rolls, when you create all this rhetoric, I mean, this is a very sane statement that is being made here. But if you're reading the newspaper, if you're watching other TV channels, the sort of aggression that is being unleashed accompanying this whole thing, government has directed the
okay.
The Law Commission.
I think you made a, you have to respond to that other one.
Yes.
There is, on the one hand, everybody agrees there is need to look at the personal laws of all religions. The government now says, you know, examine the issue of uniform civil code. Now, is there a way in which this whole issue can be depoliticized and looked at? Is the government interested in depoliticizing the issue?
Definitely. We agree that we should not merge this reform of the personal law with the uniform civil code. They are two aspects. I agree with the debate here that reform of personal law is a need of our, and every religion needs that. And that should come, the demand should come from those people, from those religion or that community itself. The second thing is, but as a government or party, we feel that there should be a debate, larger debate on uniform civil code, and it requires whether it should be there or not. It will be later on decided.
Okay.
But the debate should start, and that is very important, and that is only advisory role that has been
polarized the country.
Absolutely, that's the question. That's the question John raised. Can we have a debate on this whole issue without polarizing the country, which is what everybody's concern seems to be? Because otherwise, everybody agrees that there is need for reforms as far as the personal laws are concerned. Whether we could have a uniform civil code, it's a completely different issue. But then, can we have this debate without polarizing the country is what is a big question which needs to be answered. Thanks to all my guests. Please keep watching. We'll come back with another issue in the big picture same time tomorrow.